You know, because of climate change, no storms really are quite alike these days. What was so unique about Typhoon Goreng? What can you tell us about that?
Well, I'm no technical person in this, but basically, it's the decreasing and increasing intensity from a typhoon to a super typhoon and to a typhoon again, from no tropical wind signal to a five earlier, and then back to just three earlier. So basically, that's what the president has said during his sauna, that for all those in government, particularly those working in disaster risk reduction and management, to be on guard, to be one step ahead, because there's this ever-changing phase of disasters because of climate change, and therefore we have to be one step ahead, especially focused on providing adequate, efficient, and timely response to those who may be needing it all levels of government.
Yeah, so you said it was ever-changing, specifically Typhoon Goreng, and things turn quickly. Is that what you're saying as well? It's not just it's ever-changing, but things turn around quickly.
Yes, exactly. And also, that is why we have to be prepared all the time, because just when we thought we have prepared enough, then nature or disasters change, it unleashes its powers differently. So we have to adapt fast.
Mm-hmm. All right. And when you look at all these areas, how could things have been mitigated?
Well, policies and guidelines are in place. There are certain protocols. It's just that we can't really predict 100% what nature has and will unleash to us. But as I've said, if we are prepared, because we have, for example, as mandated by the law, we have four thematic areas according to RA 10121. So it's not just response, but if we prepare along the line of prevention and mitigation, these are the science-based approaches on things, and as well as preparedness, training, capacitating people, capacitating LGUs, and everybody on the ground, so that they could respond better in times of disasters. Of course, so the president has emphasized on response, immediate response, actually, and he encouraged everyone, he gave guidance for government to be providing, when needed, the necessary response efforts and resources one step ahead.
Yeah, and conversely, Director Posadas, were there any areas, any province that you thought would really get affected, but because of prevention or mitigation projects, that they actually did and fared well despite the expected damage brought by Typhoon Goreng?
Well, let me put it this way, Carmina. I got in touch with our regional offices, I think the other day, and I asked them, do they need anything from national government? They said the regional resources, particularly those of the local government units on the ground, can still suffice for the response efforts. And that's one good thing, that they have been more and more capacitated, they have been more empowered. And because of this, they just mobilized their plans, their disaster plans, and they utilize their local dream funds according to how they planned it to be. And there's less and less of this, immediate requests from national government for assistance. And I think that this empowerment, it translates to better and a more efficient handling of our response efforts.
Yeah, and the synergy between and among concerned government agencies, right?
Yes, yes. Because there's always a beyond government approach, actually, Carmina. It's the whole of nation approach. We need everybody on board. We need every individual to be committed to their own safety so that we could achieve our goal of national resiliency.
All right. So even if, you know, nature unleashes its power and it's ever-changing and things turn around quickly, based on, you know, just a few minutes ago, based on what you said, how do you think, how soon can all the affected residents go back to their homes, establish a sense of normalcy once again after Super Typhoon Goreng has left?
Of course, Carmina, this depends on how the local chief executives, the local government sees see it as safe already for these people to return. But I think with Hannah coming in with the same route that will be taken by her predecessors, I think it would be best to keep this our Kababayans in the evacuation centers meantime, and to implement further our preemptive evacuation measures.
Yeah, which
to keep them safe.
Just
to keep them safe, because Hannah will still be is expected to enhance still the southwest monsoon or the Habagat, which will bring rains.
Yeah, which brings me to my next question, because Hannah is there, as you said, it's going to traverse the same path somewhat. Do you think that, are you expecting that even if the LGUs and your regional offices, even if they can handle things as we speak, do you think that once Hannah leaves, and that's the time that the national government will step in, maybe because, you know, of dwindling resources because of back to back weather disturbances?
Yes, of course. Even now, when they need it, we have the resources available. That is our commitment. And anytime when they need it, then we can provide the necessary additional resources. But we have yet to receive, as I've said, requests from them. And I think this is one good sign that they have prepared, even in terms of resources and financial management, that they have prepared for things like this. And we would like to thank them and congratulate them for doing a good job.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Director Edgar Posadas, their spokesperson of the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council, thanks again for joining us this noon.
Thank you, Carmina. Good afternoon.
Take care.